today as well. And Sister Jones has shown an interest from her even younger days in wanting to participate and in involving herself in the church worship and in other manners of church activity. And she's a recent graduate of the Academy at Shawnee this year. And in speaking with her, she expressed and agreed through her expression that she would be the speaker for today. I'm asking that you pray with her and for her. I know that her nerves are on edge. This is not something she does every day, let alone every Sunday, as those who stand before people are publicly know that it's not an easy thing to do, but with God's help, indeed it can be done. And I thank her for her courage and her willingness again. So I'm asking that you receive at this time our youth speaker for today, our own Sister Jameer Jones. Let us receive her by saying amen.
I'm very nervous, but we're going to get through this today. A lot of notes. I have a lot of notes. Our theme for today is perfection, and our subject is Jesus, the perfect example. Our scripture comes from Luke 2, verse 41 through 51. Every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. When Jesus was 12 years old, he went to the festival as usual. When the festival was over, they went home, but Jesus stayed in Jerusalem. His parents did not know about it. They traveled for a whole day thinking that Jesus was with them in the group. They began looking for him among their family and close friends, but they did not find him. So they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him. Jesus was sitting in a temple area with the religious teachers listening and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and wise answers. When his parents saw him, they wondered how this was possible. And his mother said to him, "Son, why did you do this to us? Your father and I were very worried about you. We have been looking for you." And Jesus said to them, "Why did you have to look for me? You should have known that I must be where my Father's work is." But they did not understand the meaning of what he said. Jesus went with them to Nazareth and obeyed them. His mother was still thinking about all these things. Today, I'm going to be talking about Jesus' four areas of growth. And it really shocked me, because he's only 12. And he was able to survive in Jerusalem for 3 days alone in a temple with teachers and rabbis, and to be able to communicate with them as if he was their age, which is, it shocks a lot of people, because that's happened to me before. My little sister, Malia, she's 9, and she speaks to me as if she's 19 like me. Jesus grew in wisdom, and that means mentally. Wisdom is the intellectual and mental life. Jesus read, he memorized scriptures, he asked questions, and he learned. He answered those questions when he was called upon as well. He went to school, and he was a good student, but not in getting good grades because he was God incarnate, but because he studied and he took his studies very seriously, which is very important, especially for all of y'all that are still in school. The second area of growth, Jesus grew in stature, which is physically. As a young boy, teenager at that, or female, we do tend to grow, our bodies change, and we start to get stronger, we start to have better coordination, and we learn more. We're able to get a better understanding. And our next area of growth is Jesus grew in favor with God, which is spiritually. And, sorry. I speak very fast when I'm nervous. I'm sorry. Growing in favor with God, Jesus learned to worship his Father. He studied the scriptures and he mined out of them that the grand truths that help anyone face dark days and long days. As teenagers, we're going through so many changes with our body, our minds, spiritually, and mentally. We go through a lot of things. And for me, when I first started growing into my teenagerness, I was rebellious. I spoke back when I wasn't supposed to, and I got hit back. I acted out in school, which was a bad decision, because I believe my sixth grade year, I acted out so bad that I ended up failing. People make mistakes, we do, but it's better to learn from them after you make them, so that you can help someone else. And at the time, I wasn't listening to my mother, and I wasn't as in tune with my spiritual self as I am today. I didn't want to listen to anybody. I wanted to do it myself. And that was my downfall, actually, because I eventually learned that I need to bring my problems to God and talk to him if I can't talk to anyone else, to bring it to him, and that he would help me and lead me and guide me in the right direction. And also that alone, me bringing my problems forth and talking to him, created a bond that I didn't know that I could have with him. Our last area of growth is Jesus grew in favor with men, and that's socially. And this happens to be my favorite because I'm a social butterfly. And I wasn't before, a few years ago, but I am now. And in the passage, it says, Jesus grew in favor with men. He knew how to get along with people, and he knew how to talk and converse, ask questions, and give subtle answers, and avoid bad people. As Jesus grew in favor with men, he most likely had a group of friends who were always trying to rile him up and get him in trouble. I have experience in that. He must have had friends who tried to help him and be there for him. Those are the good kind of friends that we need. That's my church family, you guys. He knew how to be polite in turning down those bad friends that were trying to get him in trouble. Jesus was perfect, and it took a lot of willpower, I'm sure, for him to go through the physical changes as a young man. Temptation to rebel, temptation to keep in his sexual urges. It's something that everybody goes through. And if Jesus can do it, we should all be able to do that. And I'm sure it's hard, it is. But for us to have this example of Jesus as a teenager, right here, it shows that we can conquer anything. And there were plenty of tests we know about Jesus through his adult trials, but we never really think about him as a teenager and how hard it must have been for him to carry so much on him, because he is God incarnate. So that's a lot of, I'm sure it's a lot of pressure. And I don't know what I would be able to do, or how I would be able to handle it myself. Right here it also says that Jesus was accused of drinking and, I'm sorry, I'm kind of losing my train of thought. Jesus was accused later in life of being glutton and drunkard, and that means that he liked to eat and drink. But certainly, Jesus knew how to balance those two things out. As a teenager, I have dabbled in the things that I'm not supposed to do, such as smoking marijuana and drinking alcohol, which is illegal, so don't do it. But it wasn't for me. I have a lot of acquaintances, some friends that like to smoke and drink. And they try to get me to go out and let's go party and we're gonna do this and we're gonna go smoke this blunt real quick. We're gonna go get some alcohol from the store. And I tried it first, but I knew it wasn't for me. So I was like, I'll go, but I'm kind of gonna just like stay to myself. Or I recently went to a graduation party after I graduated, and there was smoking and drinking, but me and my close friends decided we were gonna stay away from it. And we were gonna go dance in this corner, and where we were at, there were multiple people that would come up to us and, hey, I wanna come smoke, y'all wanna come drink this? And you know, I was like, first off, I was like, no. And some other of my friends were like, yeah, let's go, let's do this. And it's not smart to be in a place that you're not familiar with, and to start messing with your head. And to be honest, it throws everything out of whack for me. It threw my whole consciousness out of whack. And I didn't like that feeling at all. I'm losing my train of thought again. I'm so sorry. As I looked back in the scripture and I was reading, I learned a lot about myself while I was going through this, and while I was learning it, because I didn't know at first, but I do have to learn all of this and to first deal with it with myself before I can come up here and speak to the youth and or the adults in my church. The first thing that got to me was that Jesus was 12 and he had the confidence, the mature confidence, to be able to go into this temple, to be able to talk to these rabbis and teachers with such confidence and wisdom that they had to step back and look, this young boy is 12 and he's coming to me and he's talking to me and he's teaching me as well. And that alone, I'm sure, was a shock. And for his parents to come back 3 days later and see that their 12-year-old son is doing what he was born to do, he set out on his journey to be all about his father's business. And that's what we need to do, especially as the youth and teenagers, because we set an example for those who are younger than us. I never knew how much of an impact I had on my younger siblings in my church until my little sister, Malia. Every Sunday I would start coming to church, she'd be like, sister, sister. And it just shocked me because she's so young, and she would come up to me, she would talk to me, and she would speak to me. I had an incident happen a few Sundays ago at home, and she happened to be there. And although she was hurt, she sat down with me and she talked to me and asked me if I was okay, as if I was the little sister. And she has such a kind spirit. And she's so little. And that's what shocked me the most, because she's so young. And I noticed when I was talking to my mother not long ago that she can be shocked by some of the things that come out of my mouth. Because I'm young. I'm still young. But we have to listen to our elders. Although we might not like what they say to us or how they say it, or if it changes anything in our life, they're saying it for a good reason. There's always our parents were teenagers as well. They know how everything goes down. They know what happens when you leave that door. And we just brush it off. While I was reading with my mom, she had, we were talking about Jesus being obedient and disobedient. And when I first read the first part of the scripture where he had stayed in Jerusalem, in my head I was like, well, that's disobedience. That he didn't ask his parents if he could stay. But as I continued to read on, he said, you should have known I was in my father's house about his business. And then I realized he was being disobedient to his earthly parents, but to his father, he was doing exactly what he was called to do. And when I was younger, I had felt like my calling was teaching. I was, I believe I was still in middle school when I had asked Mr. Loris to talk to Bishop about me being able to teach the classroom. And that, that made me think about, I think I was either 12 or 13 at the time where I said I wanted to teach. And that kind of made me think that I needed to be more of an example to my peers and to some of the adults that were in my life, because some adults are very immature themselves. Some of them aren't as grown up themselves. So I realized while I was going over this that I wouldn't just be talking to the youth, I would be talking to adults as well. And some of us are still going through changes. We have things that happen. We have dark days, we have light days. Sometimes we just shut down. But I've been thinking a lot about some of the things that are happening with me. I decided to take a break between high school and college. Not too long of a break, I'll be starting in spring. But just because I wanted to get some of my ducks in a row, because I wasn't fully prepared to go out on my own. And I had talked to my mom about it, and she told me I could stay home as long as I needed to, especially while I was in school. And that showed me that I don't have to try and get out of the house as fast as possible. I don't have to try and grow up as fast as possible. Because when I was younger, I couldn't wait to be a teenager. I couldn't wait to turn 13 because I was a teenager. Couldn't wait to turn 16 so I could drive and go out with my friends. Couldn't wait to turn 18 so I can do whatever I want and not ask for permission. I would love to be a kid again. Just to do it over and better. But I realize now that I am still a child. And I have a lot more to learn and to teach and to give to others. I have so much wisdom that I want to share it. You know, there's no reason for anyone to be so wise and just keep it all in. And I love kids. I'm going to college to major in early childhood development education. And that came out so jumbled. To be able to give back to this church alone is what inspired me to work in early childhood development and education. I really wanted to, start off at church teaching. And although I was young when I first asked, I realized that when Bishop had told me that I could teach in the classroom on some Sundays as long as it was okay with another teacher, I realized that that was my chance to start off and help. I had some of my peers come up to me and they're just like, you did so good, thank you. We need someone old around our age to talk to us. And I thought that way too as I was still in class. I was like, well, it's a lot easier to talk to someone who's closer to our age. But although we might not receive the information the way that we can understand, but eventually, you're going to be able to look back and be like, oh, I learned about this. I know this. And that happened to me a lot while I was going over this. I was thinking back, and I'm just like, well, we talk about Jesus. We don't talk about Teen Jesus. We don't we talk about baby Jesus and adult Jesus. And that's really the only representations that we have of him. And no one ever thinks of him as a teen. And I'm losing my train of thought, I'm so sorry. And I wanted to encourage you all to read your Bibles, to start off in the beginning if you can, if you can find the willpower to sit down and you're not doing anything, or if you, your friends are like, hey, come out, you just don't want to go. Sit, read, learn, get wiser. I have, sometimes I find myself reading my Bible, and it's on my phone. I have to get a paper copy just so I can stay more focused. But I'll find myself sitting down in my room by myself, just reading my Bible, and being alone with God in my room is where I feel the most comfortable to talk to him, where I feel I can lay everything down and just speak one-on-one, just bare. And even though most of you are really young, it's something that you can start doing while you're little so that you can grow in favor with him, grow spiritually with him, so that you can also lead and teach and help everyone that's people that come into your life. And this scripture is a pretty good place to start for the young ones, just because it's talking about Jesus when he was younger. And I kind of just went over everything, all my notes. I talk really quickly when I'm nervous. I apologize. One of the questions I received were, what does being a Christian and a member of Baptist Pentecostal mean to me? And this is my home away from home. And I'm very humble and so thankful to be able to come up here and speak. And I wanted to also say that as young teens, it's not gonna come easy for you to be able to listen, even coming from someone who's around the same age as you. You know, sometimes it goes out one ear and in the other. Well, in one ear and out the other, sorry. But most of the times, even when you're not listening, you are. So you don't have to listen, but God's gonna make sure that you do. There were plenty of times where I came to church and I was tired, or especially as a teenager when I started working. I was working all the time, and if I did have a Sunday off, I wanted to stay home and sleep, or I just wanted to rest. Jesus didn't rest. He studied. He studied the word. He was able to go out and teach it. He was able to inspire others. He was able to heal and help others. There was no rest there in becoming who he is today. And we should all consider that as we grow up and as we continue to grow up. Because we shouldn't be resting just where we're at. We should want to become better and to do more. And while I was going through this with my mother last night, we were talking about how this was we were talking about it earlier this week about how this was a really good theme and subject for the teens in our church and some of the adults in our church. Because growing up, I was a very observant kid, Sometimes I didn't talk. I would just smile or wave. But I was listening, and I saw around me that there was a lot of social interactions with everyone, but that seemed to be the only thing that was keeping everybody together. You know, like they're keeping everybody together and in sync was what we had in common, or this on Facebook, or this on Instagram or Snapchat. When I look around, and adults are doing it too, not just the children. When I'm on my phone in church, I'm reading my Bible. I might get off track, but I make sure I get right back on track. But it's a distraction. And most people come to church to socialize. And sometimes that might be one of the only reasons they get up and they get out of bed. Oh, I don't want to go to church. Oh, but I got to tell such and such about this, and I got to tell such and such about that. This happened to me. And that was one of the reasons I found myself getting up. I didn't, around the time that I was working, I think I was working at Kentucky Kingdom at the time, I would talk to my friends and my peers as much as I could, but I was always tired and I was always working. So I was just like, well, such and such is going to be at church this Sunday. I'm going to go, and we're going to talk about this, we're going to talk about that. And that's not something that you want on your mind as you come into this building. You want to come in here to receive, so that you can take it with you on your way out the door. Because as you come in, you're here for one reason, and one reason only. And that's to get closer to God, to follow his footsteps, and to, there's a word in my head and I can't get it out. It's back there. It might come up to me again. But, socializing is not why we're here. And that was my biggest, that was my favorite part of this whole lesson, was the growing in, socially. Jesus grew, but he also kept people around him that he trusts by the time that he was older. And you can't trust everybody. We learned that. But when you come into this building, you should be able to. You should be able to put your trust in God, that he, whatever you have going on with you, he's going to work it out. And as a teenage Christian, it's a lot more weight on your shoulders, because you know what you have to, the standards that you have to live up to. You know that you can't go out every weekend, or even party every Saturday, because you gotta be at church the next morning. And then that, even that's not right for you to go out and act a fool the night before. It's all on your Instagram, it's all on your Facebook, everybody knows, and you just gonna go to church the next morning? And I mean, that right there is disobedient and disrespectful. And a few months ago, I was just like, I'm 18, I'm 19, I'm gonna go out, I'm gonna have spend a night with my friends. My mom said, no, you got church tomorrow. But I felt like I was grown. So in my head, I was like, well, maybe I can just say I'm going to my sister's house. And that I'll just spend the night here after we go to the party, and then make up an excuse as to why I couldn't make it. And I was thinking about it, and I was like, yeah, it's a good plan. And then I heard, oh, no, you're not. You're going to stay home. You're going to pick out your outfit for church tomorrow. And you're going to get a good night's sleep so you can wake up and hear what Bishop has said. And in my head, I'm just like, Mama? How are you in my head? But it wasn't my mother. It was God. And I was shocked, because my mama talks to me all the time, and she talks about her conversations with God, and she's like, he says, to her little girl, this is what you're going to do. And if, you know, I will step in if I have to. And that's never happened for me before. And I've rebelled plenty of times through my teenage years. I'm almost 20, so those are almost over. But I've rebelled a lot. I put myself in situations that I should not have been in. And you know, everybody says that your conscience is you speaking to yourself. It's not. It's God. He's talking to you, and he's the one on your shoulder telling you, you're not going to do this. This is what you need to do. And you don't think about it when you brush him off. You're just like, no, this is what I'm about to go do. And there's so much temptation and desire to do things. I've had so many tempting things come at me. I've wanted to stay out all night. I had a curfew when I went to a party once. It was right around the corner. It started at 8 and it ended at 1 in the morning. And also for me, that seemed very unreasonable. But just because I was working, I was tired. My mama was like, 1 o'clock in the morning? Oh, sorry. my mama was like, 1 o'clock in the morning? No, you'd be home by 12:30. And I was like, I'm 18. I can do what I want. But anything could have happened to me while I was out trying to party, whether it was around the corner or not. While I was trying to give in to my teenage ways with my friends, while I was trying to give in to it, I realized this isn't for me. I like to go out, I like to hang out with my friends. But now we go out and we go get food. Or we'll go to a movie. And you don't have to give in to peer pressure to be able to fit in socially. You know, you don't have to smoke, you don't have to drink, you don't have to go to parties shaking everything your mama gave you in front of a bunch of boys. You know? You don't have to objectify women either, boys, to fit in. If you have to remove yourself from a situation, you can do it. I personally don't care what people think. You know, I've had people tell me, oh, you lame, are you lame? Well, I'll be lame at home and not out sinning. And my friends would look at me and they'd be like, are you stuck up? It doesn't mean you're stuck up, it just means that I'm wise and I choose to listen. And I have to start closing in. My 30 minutes is up. But one of my other questions were, how has this affected your life? Being a member of Baptized Pentecostal. And it's affected me tremendously. You know, there's never a day, I think, that I don't go without talking about my church family. Or I can't wait to go to church. I can't wait to see my family. And also another question was, what person or persons that have had the greatest influence in my life? My mother, one, Miss Judy King, and Miss Laura Stone. She's not here today. But they have left a great influence on me as a young woman, growing up, how to dress, how to act, listen to my mother, obey my mother, and keep her best interests. And that's all I have. You guys have any questions you want to ask me? I will answer them.
Right. Were there any questions that you would like to ask? Or? Sister Jameer?
Yes, sir.